Hi, everyone, and welcome to this episode of Practice Perspectives, Voices of Experience. I'm so happy today to have two good friends of mine with us, Katie Robbins and Kelly Spilios. Today, we're going to be talking about all things mammo and breast cancer related because here we are in October, and that's what we do in October. So Kelly comes to us from Streamline MD, a company in the radiology world that a lot of us know and love. And Katie comes to us also from the radiology world as a marketing expert. So we're talking to you about breast cancer today and about mammography. And we understand that most of you watching this know a lot about mammo and know a lot about this because it is our radiology world. And an interesting thing I want to point out, when I was having a pre-webinar chat with both Kelly and Katie, I said to them, everybody joining us already knows about mammography. This is a radiology audience. They know what mammo is. They understand the breast cancer scares, the 1 in 8, all the things. So we're not really teaching them anything. We're going to talk about your story. And then I realized it really hit me after that phone call that we had yesterday. And I really started thinking about it and how wrong I was to say that. Because you know what? You are going to teach us so much. Because I think that unless we have sat in your seat and we have heard the diagnosis that you both have heard and we have endured the treatment and getting well and recovery, we don't know everything. We know nothing. So you are definitely going to teach us so much here. And I'm just so happy that you're both here and are willing to share your stories with us. I gave you a little bit of intro into Kelly and Katie, but I want you both to tell us and give us your own intro. Tell us a little bit about yourself and what you do in the radiology space. Kelly, let's start with you.
Sure. I just want to thank you, Dianne, for having me as a panelist today. I think this is fantastic, and I really appreciate the opportunity. I'm the director of revenue cycle at Streamline MD, and we provide revenue cycle solutions for radiology and interventional radiology practices. And we have a certified electronic health record for the outpatient setting, such as an OBL.
Nice. And that's how I got to know you through that world. And I'm so happy that we've met. And then Katie, tell us a little bit about you.
Again, thank you for letting me join you and Kelly here today. It's been an honor getting to talk to Kelly as well. So I am the owner of Frame 42 Marketing. We do radiology marketing mostly. And prior to this, I was in the radiology field and the practice side for roughly 15 years almost, but have been in some form or fashion of healthcare marketing since, gosh, the 90s, a long time.
Yeah. And for those of you in who know some of us in the industry and a lot of our viewers sometimes are people that we do know, Katie had comes from a practice before her own business. Now, congratulations on that, by the way. Not new, but I never hesitate to congratulate you again just for doing what you're doing independently. It's amazing. But you know, Katie is one of those that, Katie, you've been a role model for me and my role in marketing. And for so many of us in radiology marketing, what you did and the team you created was the gold standard. And we all, and especially those of our friends in RBMA, and a lot of our RBMA membership watches and joins us for these webinars. So you're known and you're loved. Kelly has jumped right into RBMA as well and gotten very involved in committees and all. And we all know that radiology is a small world and we all care very much about one another. And again, we all care very much about the both of you being here. I'm so excited. So we're going to jump right in because you know me, and if you know Katie and Kelly both, we all could talk a lot and we want to try to keep this a little bit limited to an hour. So thank you all for being here. Let's get right into this. So I know this is true for me, and obviously I think for you two both, we work in the radiology world, right? We kind of know how to go around the corner sometimes and get information that we need, or we know the experts to ask. And we have so much access to our information, sometimes quickly, sometimes not. And then also not just being in the radiology industry, but now that we have, you know, access to patient portals, which is a big part of our life as both patients and providers, right? To have the access to your medical health records at a touch. And sometimes immediately. And sometimes those records are available to us as soon as those reports come through from the radiologist dictation system, and they're in there and we just might see them before our referring physicians do, or our own physicians in that case. And sometimes that's great. Sometimes that can be a little bit problematic. And I think, Kelly, why don't you talk to us about that? And what happens when you know how to go get information and maybe you find out information on your own that you weren't prepared to see?
Yeah, sure. So I had my very first mammogram on May 25th of 2021, about 10 o'clock in the morning. As you said, I'm familiar, right? We work in healthcare. We know those portals are there. And so May 26th, about 10 o'clock in the morning, I logged into the portal and I was on the phone with a coworker, which was, you know, I just thought it was just casual, like as we were just talking, and I logged in and, you know, saw the size of a mass and suspicious malignancy. And yeah, I'll never forget that feeling. and as you said, I knew that before my referring doctor. So I was the one making the outbound call back to my doctor.
So Kelly, tell us a little bit about that. Tell us a little bit about that diagnosis and just your story. Let's get a brief little, some insight into you and insight into when you got that diagnosis. What, tell us about it. Tell us about your story.
Sure. I had just turned 43. And I went through just, you know, having my normal mammogram to biopsy. I ended up having two biopsies, which confirmed invasive ductal carcinoma. I had lymph node involvement, which I knew at least one lymph node was positive. So that was my diagnosis. And then, you know, my treatment plan included radical mastectomy. After that, followed chemotherapy, radiation, hysterectomy, reconstruction. So it's a lot.
It is a lot. It is a lot. And that was 2 years ago now, correct?
Yep.
Very good. Congratulations on that. Katie, what about you? Now, I know that you, all of us in radiology, October is just crazy. There's no better word to describe October for those of us in radiology that have anything to do with mammo. It's crazy. It's busy. It's chaotic. And you and the practice you were with, you were actively involved in all sorts of outreach, both to referring physicians and to consumers. And a lot of your focus was all things mammo. Get those mammograms. I know that you worked, you put together even an Emmy Award winning video that was just, I honestly have chills right now thinking about it. What a great job you did with that. So in the middle of this, in the middle of a chaotic October, suddenly things changed for you. Tell us a little bit about your introduction into this side of the mammo world.
Sure. Yeah. You know, you prep all you can for October, but you know, you're never 100% prepared, I feel like. And that October in 2015 was really no different. We had just completed a video, the video that you're talking about, Living Proof Screening Saves, which had won this Emmy Award, was huge. These survivors just made incredible conversations in our office and in our referring practices, and women just, their stories are just incredible. I was humbled by it. And we had a news reporter that had come through and gotten her mammogram. And normally I'm the girl that would do that because, you know, who wants to be on camera getting their mammogram? So I would always take one for the team because they needed a true patient and I was of age. So fast forward a month and, you know, this reporter had reached out to me and she was like, Katie, did you get your mammogram? No, I had not. And I didn't want to tell her that. So of course I scheduled, I got it. It was the Wednesday before Thanksgiving. And the next week I was diagnosed with invasive ductal carcinoma. And a few days after that, we found out it was triple negative and I was 42. It was kind of a walking example of why you should go every single year. It wasn't there the year before, but it was there then. And 3D mammogram and subspecialized radiologists were how we found it. So can't say enough great things about that. So
makes a difference. How does October feel now, Kelly? How does October feel for you? What you see, you know, you both of you have so generously not only agreed to talk with me and talk with us here, but you are advocates and speak a lot about this. And we'll get to that in a moment. We'll talk a little bit about more about that. But just here we are, October, and there's pink ribbons everywhere. And everybody's wearing pink or you're seeing pink. And it's just it's invasive, you know, just the whole messaging. So does it feel different now? Do you, Kelly, how do you feel when you're out and you see all of this? Does it make you happy that the awareness is there? Does it trigger? I know we talked a little bit before, and both of you talked about there's a lot of PTSD involved here with having such a diagnosis and going through what you've been through and surviving all the stuff that is hard. Gosh, I say that, and you know, you can say it, I can't. But how does it feel like October? What does that seem like now? What does it do to you?
You know, I'll be honest with you. Last year, I was 1 year out. You know, I feel like it was a little bit rough. It was like it reminded you of what you had gone through, and you're not quite done, or you're just right at the end, or whatever. And I always kind of felt like October was commercialized. You know, oh, pink ribbons, and you hear people say that, like, oh, it's just commercialized, because I wasn't close to it.
Yeah.
But now, like this year, I was like so pumped for October. I was like, you know, let's get out there and let's support other people. Let's talk about it. When I was going through chemotherapy the first year, my employer and all of my staff made a team for the walk. And we did the walk in October, and it just reminded me, I guess, of just how everybody's just there with you. And when I was walking, somebody came up to me. I did the walk myself because I'm very stubborn. And someone came up, they said, it's not for you to walk. But someone came up to me and they said, we do this for you. This is for you. And I just feel like that now, like this is for that person that needs it. Obviously, you know, I enjoy it as well, but it's for the next person.
Yeah, I agree. I'll never forget the first time I was at an event. It actually wasn't in October, but it was during my chemotherapy process. And they said, let all the survivors stand up so we can cheer them on. And I was like, oh boy, I'm standing up. Like it kind of took my breath away a little bit for a moment, even as prepared as I feel like I've been through the years for all the knowledge that I've had. And similarly, that first October, was filled with opportunities to talk, to speak at events, raising funds at Pink Pint Night. It was amazing. It was incredible. I have a beautiful picture from there that I just cherish, because I do still kind of cherish being new to it, if that makes sense. There's a lot that comes with that that's hard, but there's a lot that comes with that that is, it's positive. It's beautiful because you're getting a new perspective. And sometimes now I'm 7 years out, so I sort of miss it, you know. I don't get to talk as much as I used to, and I do miss that. But I think that's the biggest thing, is being able to share stories and perspectives. So,
yeah. I'm not going to cry. Y'all know I'm a crier. I can't help it. Speaking of crying about this, I will share a story, Katie, because let's just make it all about me. Why don't we? your diagnosis, you know, around the end of the year, And then, so again, we talked about RBMA. We're all actively involved. So the following year, March rolls around, and it's the RBMA marketing conference. Now, you know me, give me a microphone, give me a stage, give me a platform. I'm
right there with you.
I will talk to anybody at any time. Never hesitate. And suddenly I had to get up and welcome all the marketing teams from across the country. And you just sent a picture. I think you were on a trip with your family. And I knew that I had to tell this whole group, who just loves you so much, your news, because a lot of people at that time still just didn't know. And we were all together. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to go talk about Katie. I get up there and just sobbed. Like, there were no words. I was just sobbing. And we knew you were going to be fine. I don't know. It just hit me, because I do both of you, but Katie at the time, I love you so much. And yeah, just lost it. But just, I know that you knew, and I know we made videos for you and sent to you from those meetings, just how much you are loved. And Kelly, I feel it when you talk about Harry and Streamline and the whole team there and your employer and just people. We do love you all. And we, when people care about you, that is just, that's what we do. We rally and we'll cry with you and we'll laugh with you. And right now I want to be able to share in your experience so that with you, we're also helping other people understand what you've been through. And I'm kind of leading up to, we talked a little bit about working in the industry and kind of having access to things and kind of knowing the secret workarounds to get more information or to get, you know, expert advice that maybe, you know, you wouldn't have gotten otherwise. But here's, I want to take this another direction for a moment, because one of the things too, and it's been interesting for me, and Katie, you talked about missing some of those things. And I think you refer to not, maybe not being on the, on that side of your old job where it's, you know, we're constantly doing the same with me. This is my first October, not working in private practice where it's just every single day we're out there. Fortunate to work for AbbaDox, who's still very actively involved with the mammo workflow solution and also giving back to this important mission and cause. So it still keeps me involved, which I love. But one of the things that, you know, a lot of our listeners, our customers, our audience, all the people that you and I, all three of us work with, we're in the radiology business. A lot of people out there listening are running breast care centers or mammo programs, or their mammo techs or their operators of these centers. And here's what I want to talk about. When I made the comment in the beginning about, yes, you absolutely can teach us something. I think that, you know, we've all at times been patients for various things. And it's one thing to be the patient and go in for, you know, my spinal MRI because my back hurts. Okay, yeah, that's a big deal, but that pales in comparison. When you are a patient going through something where you're terrified, you don't know what's going on. You think you do because you know the industry, but then when it's you, you don't, because it's you and the emotions take over. What can we as providers, what can those of us who are watching, who are in this business every single day, taking those patients back for their mammograms and doing the, you know, the workflow, the techs, the sonographers, the radiologists who are reading it, the people who are communicating with you, what are some things that made the difference to you, maybe for the good or for the bad, that you might want to share that we can learn from as an industry, as a business, as a subspecialty? What was your experience as a patient, and what are some takeaways that might help those of us who will see that next patient do a better job for her or him? Kelly, do you want to start with that?
Sure. You know, I had a little bit of a bumpy ride in the beginning. You know, as I just mentioned, I got my mammogram results the next morning. It was before my doctor told me. And I was making outbound calls, and I had to wait a couple of days for her to return my call because she didn't have the results because she wasn't in the same health system. It was a lot. That was a lot. And then, you know, my mammo to my biopsy result was 24 days. And that felt like absolutely forever, you know. And I think anyone who's ever experienced cancer would probably agree that waiting on that biopsy result is literally the longest amount of time in your life. It just feels like your emotions are good and they're bad and they're like, I'm okay, but I'm not okay. You know, it was so strange. And I feel like maybe if there was a person in the middle there that said, okay, you've had a biopsy, you know, this is what you can expect. This is how things are going to go. And maybe other people have that in their situations, but I didn't have that. You know, and I think from like patient advice perspective is never to go to any appointments alone. Like I go to my family doctor maybe alone, but when I go to any specialty appointments or scans or whatever, I always take somebody, because I went in for an ultrasound and ended up having, you know, a biopsy, and I was there by myself, including the drive home. And I was just like, I was shocked, and I didn't have anybody there with me to ask questions, remember the answers, right? Yeah. Because it's just so overwhelming.
Yeah. I feel like I had almost the exact opposite experience from Kelly, which I think makes this a really great conversation piece, because the technology is moving so fast. It always has, but the technology right now is moving so, so fast to have reports in patients' hands faster, to have results via text message. And I think the one thing that I learned from all of this is, I mean, I used to tell patients when I did my education with them, you know, if you had to have a cancer, breast cancer is the way to go, because if you catch it early, which if you're doing all of those things, you can catch it early and be just fine. Wow. Like the farthest thing from the truth. because it is so much more than just going through treatment, to your point. There's a PTSD with this on the backside of it that is huge, but even still, each patient is different. And so for the technologists who are doing this day in and day out, they've had no training on how to handle a patient who's facing this. Like, doctors get some of that training, but technologists get trained on how to use the machine and how to position the breast tissue and this and that. So they're either born with those skills or they're not. And there's some training in there that goes, I had been the customer experience officer at my last practice, was a role that I had picked up just before I got diagnosed. And I think that was eye-opening for me to go through this as a customer experience officer. I was lucky enough to have an advocate, and for groups out there right now who have the ability to have a nurse navigator or even just a breast health advocate, even if she's not a nurse, who can make the phone call to the patient. Hey, you're fine. You know, your biopsy came back normal. Whew. Because how many patients get that text message that they're fine, but then still have follow-up questions and they're still scared and they're still nervous. And for the ones who are diagnosed, the hope is that their physician or the radiologist or someone at the radiology practice will reach out to them. But in Kelly's case, you know, she got on there. She's a smart woman. Let's face it. There's a lot of smart ladies out there that know how to get into their portals and get their information. And what a terrifying way to find that out. It's not routine. It's not a routine thing. It may be the routine thing for the technologist or the doctor that's going through it every day, or the practice manager who's, you know, walking patients through their office, but it's not routine for that patient. And you can be a rock star patient at a young age facing a stage 4 or 3 cancer, but the 55-year-old that comes in and has DCIS may be terrified, and she has every right to feel that way. And she needs you there to help hold her hand through this process. So I think
yeah, Katie, you're right. You're both right. What, you know, and now that, you know, patients by law can access our portals immediately, we are actually seeing more and more of that, which, you know, there are a couple ways to mitigate that. I know that one thing that we see often is there are ways, like depending on your workflow and what sort of workflow solution you have in your practice, there can be, you know, you can set up rules that can guard, maybe you put in a day buffer between the day that report is ready, then it's actually accessible so that your physician at least has an opportunity to get that first. I mean, ideally, right? You want to have that conversation and not have to endure that the way Kelly did, where you kind of felt alone in it. So, you know, there are some safeguards there. And again, we do want patients to have access to the records, but it's just that in between and those gaps where this happens to rural people, and we have to be cognizant of that. And Katie, I agree. And, you know, one of the things we see, we talk a lot now, and those of us still very involved on the private practice side of things, Kelly, I know you see this too, just from an RCM perspective with the practices that you work with, but staffing is hard. And finding techs is hard. And one of the things I'm seeing is where a lot of practices, a lot of places, maybe we're hiring people and pushing them through quicker than we would have in ideal hiring circumstances, or maybe they're not getting all the training that we would have taken the time to give someone if staffing weren't so tight, if the radiology space wasn't so, what is the word? Just busy. Yeah. Busy is probably the best word right now. We don't have enough radiologists to read the studies. A lot of our mammo centers are backed up. There's a long wait now sometimes between that screening mammo where you find out something could be going on to the longer than ever. Times that, you know, several years ago, we would have been unheard of to make a patient wait this long between a screening and their diagnostic. And those things are happening, and it's very real. So when you combine, you know, maybe techs that haven't had, not that they're not good techs and not that they won't be fantastic, but maybe the timing is just pushed so that they're not quite prepared. So this is why I wanted to talk about this, because it's very real. We talk about, okay, well, now we're staffed, we have mammo techs, and now we can get you in, but But is that that patient is still, that is her experience. That is your experience. And what is happening in that moment doesn't matter how understaffed you are. And it doesn't matter how much training that tech has or hasn't had in really how to communicate with patients. If it happens to you, that's what happened. And it's not okay. And we have to never lose that human side of this. You know, we do have workflows and we do have, you know, automated processes that make everything so good and so easy. And that's wonderful. But that human touch, we have to remember that no matter what, you're the patient in that moment and your experience is all that matters to you. And it has to be appropriate. And it has to be, what is the word I'm looking for here, Katie? It just has to
be real.
We can't dismiss every single incident with every single patient, right?
And Kelly touched on this. Her experience with her employer was phenomenal. And my experience with my employer was phenomenal. I mean, they backed you up and it was great. It starts there, right? So you've hired a new tech and she's slammed because post-COVID, there's more women who are now being diagnosed and there's more biopsies happening and all of these things in that diagnostic side of the breast imaging is happening. And so they're rushed and they're busy and they get burned out. Who's taking care of them? The employer. So the practice leaders that are listening, I can't stress enough how important it is to take care of your people, because when you take care of your people, they want to take care of your practice. And I, you know, we can train them with customer experience and all of that, but there's nothing says I want to do a good job for my practice like I'm backed up back here by my boss. You know, the doctors that work with me care about me. And so I want to care about their patients. Because if you come to work and you're stressed out, and who knows what's going on in your own world, and then you're expected to rush through the day with more patients than normal, and there's no way you're going to give them the best experience. Like, you have to have people talking and communicating and being supportive of one another. So I'm thankful.
And we know that 7 out of 8 of those patients are just fine. And if they're rushed, they're rushed, right? But how do you know who's that 1 in 8, right? Yeah. That needs it. And so everyone is that 1 when you're there getting your screening, or when you're there being the patient, you're the 1 until you're not, or until you are. Yeah. Let's talk about a couple things. I know that we talked a little bit about this yesterday, and Kelly, I loved your stories about this. I think that when you're going through something like this, you again, this is your story, not mine. So I'm repeating some of the things that you and other patients have taught me, including my mom. But you do what you have to do to cope, right? And sometimes coping is funny. Sometimes coping is crying. Sometimes coping, it looks different on everyone. I will tell you, I brought up my mom. I'll tell you just a quick story too. My mom was diagnosed with breast cancer when I was in college, and she was 55 years old. And it was in the, here's my age here, but it was around 1990. And I remember, and I wasn't in medicine. I was adjacent to clinical medicine. I was still in school, but I was working in a hospital setting as well as at the medical school. And I was just learning. I didn't come from a medical background, but I was just learning, like, okay, my mom is of an age that she needs to have a mammo. And so I made her go. She had a mammogram. She was diagnosed very early. She went through a mastectomy, chemo, did fine. Not unlike you, she worked almost, both of you worked every single day. She had to travel a little while to get her chemo, about 1.5 hours. So obviously she didn't work that day, but otherwise she never stopped working, because that's what we do, right? We have to take care of our families. We have to take care of everything. She didn't stop working, but the humor with her came later. So my mom has passed away now, not from breast cancer. She lived close to 30 plus years after her diagnosis and lived very well. She passed away several years ago, but she lived for about the last 10 years with Alzheimer's. And so again, we talk about coping and coping mechanisms. And with her, she never chose to have reconstruction. So she only had 1 breast. And after she got a little more advanced with her Alzheimer's, this is bad. I mean, I'm the bad daughter, maybe. I don't know. But we would tease her a little bit if I would help her bathe. Mom, well, why do you only have one breast? And she would just get really disheveled sometimes, and she just thought she left it somewhere. Or that's awful. In retrospect, that sounds horrible, but that was me coping with her having Alzheimer's. But the point of sharing that is just, she just lived this, you know, she died of something that happens with very old age, and she was very old even then, so lived a very long, successful life. But it was that early diagnosis, it was that mammogram that, yeah. You know, Katie, you talked about that, and it is true. When diagnosed early, absolutely long, healthy lives after. In that moment, though, that's not what you're thinking. As you referenced earlier, in that moment, you think that's easy for me to say. Me, not easy when you're getting that diagnosis. But I do want to talk about your coping mechanisms. Katie, you said that you wrote, and you used Caring Bridge as a place to write. And I know that you're a great writer, and that is something that we've talked about before. It's very important to both of us. And I think that you coped by writing and talking about your story. And that was helpful for you. Is that how you kind of expressed, kind of got it out?
Yeah, we did. I did a lot of writing. It allowed me to reach people. And I felt like that was the reason. You know, sometimes you feel like you know why something's happened, and sometimes you don't. Why me? I felt like why me, because we were going through the U.S. task force, some of their recommendations and changes with other organizations in the industry who had changed some of their recommendations. And here I was, this poster child, and I wanted to be a mouthpiece. And so Caring Bridge was a way for me. But make no mistake, humor was right there with us. I mean, from the night I was diagnosed in the Target with my husband, I'm trying to find something, and I put it in the buggy, and he goes, we can't afford that right now. And I was like, but I have breast cancer. And he was like, you did not just say that.
You have to use your card.
So we turned the corner a few aisles down. He put something in. I was like, we don't need that. He's like, my wife has breast cancer. So, you know, and I could probably tell 100 more stories, but Kelly's is pretty priceless. I got a big kick out of your take.
I got a glimpse into Kelly's coping mechanism last night. Kelly, tell us what you did.
Well, I mean, from the beginning, I shared all of my details on Facebook, and I realized that that's not what everyone would want to do. I felt like for me, I didn't want to keep repeating it over and over. What are you doing? How are you doing? What's next? So I put everything out there. And I did have a lot of people reach out to me and say, you know, thank you for sharing that. I'm going through the same thing, including the mental health, you know, PTSD. That's something that you just don't really talk about. And so I was so focused. My mom kept saying, you're going to be fine once you have a plan, because that's just how you are. And I was so focused. And I had someone tell me, just be careful, because when you get to the last piece, which for me, and the treatment was radiology or radiation, and that could be hard, that last piece. And I had 25 radiation treatments. And so I went in the first day, and I was like, okay, I'm going to have this positive attitude, and I'm going to like this, and it's going to be great. And I was in the dressing room, and I saw something funny. Like, it was like this, the cabinet where you put your clothes had like this grate on it. And I thought, this looks like a jail, like a jail cell. And so I went behind it and I took a picture, and I thought it was, you know, kind of funny. And I posted it because everybody was following me on Facebook. And then they were like, oh, and somebody said something else. And I just kind of like, oh, okay, so this is what I'm going to do. So I had this small bag that I carried in that looked like it was like my clothes. And every day I just set something up as like a funny picture. And like, it was Olympic time. So I had made these like skis out of cardboard and pretended like I was like skiing in the Olympics. We did just all different types of things. And it was really funny to see what I could smuggle in this little tiny bag every day without the techs or anyone noticing. And it was my
last. They didn't know what you were doing back there in the dressing room, taking so long.
And I was trying to do it really fast, right? Because I was like, you know, they probably think, why is it taking her so long to get dressed? And so on my last day of radiation, I brought them this big plate of cookies that were like bikinis and things like that, bikini tops. And I had linked my YouTube, I had given it to one of the techs while I was in my last treatment. And when I came out, they were just dying laughing, because I put together all the different days into a montage. And you know, that's just me. You know, I think you, no matter what, I can find something funny, just like you, Katie. Like, I totally would have said that. Like, I'm like, I still use my card. Like, you know, how do you use it?
And, you know what, if you haven't, use it, right?
100% true.
As a matter of fact, my kids have used it. You know, my mom has cancer. And they'll say that. And I'm like, eh, you know, go ahead.
I'm really surprised that my youngest didn't use it more at school for things. But but she was in, like, the beginning stages of middle school, I think. And her, when she found out I was going to have to do chemotherapy, you know, she's like, oh, Mom, you know, like, you're going to lose your hair. And I was like, yep, I'm going to lose my hair. She's like, Are you going to lose your arm hair? And I said, yeah. She said, are you going to lose your nose hair? And I said, yeah, I think so. Maybe. Sure enough, you do lose your nose hair. It's the whole thing. And then she said, oh, Mom, are you going to lose your chick fuzz? And I was like, what is chick fuzz? She goes, Mom, the hair, you know, about the tip. Thank goodness. That's what we're talking about. Yes. And I hope it never grows back. But yeah, the humor was, I can't tell you how many times I had told that story just to kind of break the awkwardness sometimes with people, you know, because they don't know what to say. And that's hard. But I think it's just about being real with people. Don't change who you are. You know, let this be an experience that you can grow from, but that you have the opportunity to grow with others and make them feel comfortable in these settings too, I guess. So.
I think, as someone who's watched it from the outside, you know, a lot of times we don't know what to say, or we, you know, I think, and obviously it depends on your relationship with someone and what you're comfortable saying or sharing, but yeah, we don't always know what to say. And I think that having you guys again share this and talk about it, it helps us, you know, what tell me about now, like today, what are you today? What do you know? I guess, you know, you're done with treatment, you're done with cancer, but you know what? So what, I don't know how to ask this question appropriately. But who are you today? What are you today? What are you post cancer?
I'll let you go first. Kelly, if you have thoughts.
You know, at one of my first, I think it was my first oncology appointment, my husband asked the doctor, he said, how long until we get back to normal? Because she was talking, we'll have this and we'll have this and we'll have this. And she was a very sweet lady. And she just said, you're never going to be normal. You're always going to deal with PTSD. And I did not know at the time what that meant. I thought PTSD was not going to affect me, right? I'm funny. And so, you know, you go through treatments and surgeries and you just think, wow, you know, now what? And I think you just have to, I had someone who was very inspirational to me to say, you just got to do what they tell you to do, right? You just have to keep going and keep going through your follow-ups. Is it hard? Yeah, it's hard because you can't forget it. You're constantly, you know, next appointment, next appointment, next appointment. But for me, like, I feel like I've grown as a person so much. I came out the other side and I was like, even my kids said, Mom, like, you're crazy. I was crazy before, but I'm even more crazy now because you just have such an appreciation. Like, I came through all this. And when you get diagnosed with cancer, you instantly go to death. I mean, that's just, everybody does it. And you come through it and you're like, man, I made it through. And I made it through, like, yeah, I did it. And so now, like, I'm going to do whatever I want to do. You know, be you. If I want to wear something crazy, I do, right? It just gives you a different perspective, I think.
Yeah. I love that. I love it. What about you, Katie?
I embrace it 100%. You know, I am a breast cancer survivor, but more than that, I still feel very called to saying I am the reason, the poster child for why you go every year starting at 40, and don't miss it. You know, 13 months is not a year, 12 months is a year, you know, and that for me is so important. It doesn't take up space in my mind every day now. It did for a while. And that passed for a bit, but then it doesn't take much to have a little scare. And then, you know, you kind of go right back to ground zero with it. But, you know, I described my my journey on my Caring Bridge page as like going into a dark well. And sometimes you're circling around and you can't see the sunlight. You can't see the faces of the people and the supporters above you, you know, and you just have to be doing this with yourself and in my world, my, you know, God and I pushing through this. And then other times you could feel them. You could feel the sun. You had a good day. But I remember when I got about 2 years out, I had a day where I just woke up and I felt like I'd come out on the other side of that well. I had climbed up out of it. I wasn't in it. And that was huge. I appreciate the time that I was there, but I'm so excited to be on the other side of it and just a chance to really, you know, it's, I don't want to forget it. Let me put it that way. And my husband was sort of the same, Kelly, you know, okay, when are we going back to normal? Like, does this always have to be at the forefront of every conversation? And it's a major life event, right? Like I place things in history now. Okay, well, that was before cancer. So that was X, Y, and Z year. And this was during cancer. This was after cancer, you know, but yeah. Oh, I'm a survivor and a poster child.
I think you both are absolutely an inspiration to me. We talked about this a little bit earlier, and let's kind of go back there before we have to wrap up. But you've been through all of this, and you have come out so strong and so just renewed and beautiful and gracious to do this. And you still, again, we talked about it, but let's talk a little bit more about what you're doing, this advocacy that we were all somewhat already doing just because of, you know, we're fellow women, you know, we're all advocating in this together, but now you are advocating in a very different way and you are advocating and educating from the position of being a breast cancer survivor. So, you know, we all listen a little more to what you have to say. I'm going to listen to you far before I'm going to listen to me because you've been through it and you've lived it and you've walked that walk and you know it. And so the fact that you both are so actively involved in wanting to help other women who are going through this and wanting to help spread the word about the importance of screening mammography so that women who are diagnosed are diagnosed in those earliest stages. Let's talk a little bit more before we have to go about that and about what that means to you and about what it means to you to be able to do that. Katie?
So I wish I could tell you that I've had lots of opportunities to speak about it. They've been fewer and further between now post-COVID. And I think that's probably the big challenge, right? People are doing things a little differently. We're starting to see some things go back to normal. But even during that time, I got to do some, you know, stories with different hospital partners and radiology group partners. But I'll be the first to tell you, if you're out there listening, you need somebody to come talk, I'm your girl. I'd be glad to come. I love it. But where I have found my place, I feel like now, and my advocacy has been helping others who are going through it. I can't tell you the number of people that I get a call from, you know, that just say, hey, my best friend, or hey, my mom, or hey, my sister, not even them. And I'm like, yeah, pick up the phone and call me. I'll be glad to talk you through it. I'll be glad to tell you what to expect from my perspective. And I try to always be sure that people know your journey will look different and that is okay. Nobody's looks the same and that's okay. But be okay with your journey, whatever that is. And, but that's where my advocacy has been so far. That and, you know, just trying to stay on top of the women in my life to be sure they're going and getting those mammograms like they're supposed to be. So,
how about you, Kelly?
So I haven't, you know, it's only been a couple of years, so I haven't had a lot of official experience. You know, I describe being a survivor as kind of like a club that you don't want to recruit anybody. and you don't want any new members, but if you do get them, you want to welcome them. And in some ways, I feel like I took one for the team, for the people that I know, like, okay, guys, I got this. If there's a problem, you know, I can help. Now, am I the person, you know, people did this for me, but am I the person that could send inspirational quotes and be that deep person? Probably not, right? But Can I show a newly diagnosed person that you can fight and you can just live your life as normal as possible? Absolutely. And that's why I'm here, is to give hope to newly diagnosed people that you can get through it and you can be you and you can continue on with your life.
Thank you. And I know that, you know, we talk about 1 in 8 and there's a big audience here, and you're not the only ones, listening here who have gone through this or who may be facing this and who may be facing a new diagnosis. And again, our audience works in radiology. So we're working with patients every day who are newly diagnosed, and the fact that you ladies are available and could be a light and a resource, I think is beautiful and more valuable than you could even imagine. And to know that by someone else hearing your story, you, again, it sounds cliche, it is so not, that they're just not alone and that you faced it. And, you know, women of every shape and size and age and walk in life, those feelings are there, and everyone needs someone. So thank you so much. Thank you for being here with me. I just am so honored that you would both feel comfortable enough to do this and do it here. And thank you from women everywhere for being that advocate for all of us. And from a radiology operations perspective, thank you for teaching us how we can continue to do better for the patients we serve, because, you know, in our business, that's why we're here, and that is to serve the patient. And hearing from patients who can share their experiences helps us all. So thank you. For those of you listening, thank you for being here with us for Voices of Experience. Kelly and Katie, thank you for sharing your experience as breast cancer survivors and talking to us about your journey. Stay tuned for more episodes of Practice Perspectives, Voices of Experience. And also be on the lookout for more podcast episodes from our Keen Insights podcast. You know where to find us. We're always here. And thank you for joining us. Practice Perspectives, Voices of Experience is brought to you by AbbaDox. AbbaDox is a workflow solution built to optimize your radiology practices. Thank you again for being here. And we'll all see you soon.